Around 20 years ago, a video game debuted that took the foundation of its predecessor even further, forever changing the industry and, dare I say, society in the process. That game was KCE Japan and Hideo Kojima's Metal Gear Solid 2 Sons of Liberty. This will be a long-form series of video essays on MGS2 to follow up my 15-episode, 5-hour one about MGS1. We'll be delving into yet again everything we can, from the making of to MGS2's story, innovations for the medium, philosophy, and wider themes. So if that works for you, join me, your humble guide, Joran Lee, as we take a long, long trip way back in yesterday. September 3rd, 1998. With the debut of KCE Japan's Metal Gear Solid, Hideo Kojima and his team already start working on the follow-up. This echoes the little-known fact that Sony got to work on what would become the PlayStation 2 in December 1994, immediately upon the debut of the PS1. Both pieces of Sony hardware will manifest observations made by computer scientists from Apple and Intel in 1996 in a paper named How Multimedia Workloads Will Change Processor Design. It predicts that with the advent of multimedia, the fundamental structure of computer systems architecture will have to change. This has to do with the completely opposite ways dynamic and static applications require processing. Dynamic multimedia apps like 3D games and scientific simulations, unlike static apps like a text editor, use a small and mostly unchanging stream of instructions to handle large levels of a frequently changing stream of data. The ideal way to deal with this monumental change, the paper posits, is doing away with special purpose hardware and integrating all the components of digital multimedia processing onto a single integrated circuit die, one built to accommodate massive amounts of rapid data exchange between them. Because the instruction code with multimedia dynamic machines, like the PlayStation, remain simple and unchanging, they can process tons more data faster than a standard 90s-era PC by way of loops and repetitive process cycles. But because they're also built with more bandwidth, this processing can happen along much wider lanes, too. What remained classified by Sony until a leak in 97 brought it partially to light is that the PS2 will use a revolutionary, dynamic, single-die design capable of rendering a whopping 75 million polygons per second. At its heart will be the EE, or emotion engine, a fusion between a CPU and a digital signal processor. Developed by Toshiba, the EE will be put together not unlike a development team, who, by working collectively to become more than the sum of their parts, embody the slogan of the American Revolution, E Pluribus Unum, out of many, one. But Kojima's team won't get a first-hand look at a PS2 evaluation use graphics board for almost 2 months. So to start off, the director focuses first on the question of story and theme. The just-released MGS1 draws heavily from the conflict that gave birth to real-time 3D, the Iraq War. And now, it seems a second major Iraq conflict is imminent. A sequel war, the perfect topic for a sequel war game. Kojima's first spark of inspiration for what will become MGS2 comes from the controversial UNSCOM inspection incidents, as one of the team will detail in a book years and years from now named Iraq Confidential. The UNSCOM, or United Nations Special Commission, is supposed to be an international neutral task force with the objective of certifying that Saddam Hussein, Iraq's dictator, has honored the terms of the ceasefire and completely disarmed Iraq of all WMD, nuclear, chemical, and biological. Instead, allegedly, UNSCOM served as a cover for American intelligence operations in Iraq and the CIA's true objective of so-called regime change. When back on August 5th, Iraq had halted all cooperation, the U.S. responded by pushing tensions to the brink of war. And 6 days after MGS1's release, the UN Security Council passes, on September 9, 1998, Resolution 1194, an official condemnation of Iraq. 1998 is a particularly momentous year in the decade-long Pax Americana. Only 2 days after Iraq's suspension of compliance, American embassies in Nairobi, Kenya are bombed. The Washington Post reports that while no previously known terrorist organization claims responsibility, suspicion has fallen on an Egyptian wing of the so-called Islamic Jihad group, and with them, quote, a wealthy Saudi exile, Osama bin Laden. Meanwhile, back in April, the Jerusalem Post had reported that as the USSR was collapsing in late 1991, between 2 to 4 nuclear weapons were being purchased from Kazakhstan by none other than Iran. However, without the addition of former Soviet scientists, the Iranians reportedly lack the know-how needed to bypass the weapons security system. With all of these scandals and rumors floating around, particularly the Monica Lewinsky incident, that, for a moment, nearly seemed to trigger war with Iraq and may have influenced the decision to retaliate against bin Laden by bombing a hospital in Sudan and a training camp in Afghanistan, Kojima, years ahead of former UNSCOM official Scott Ritter, makes a connection between this context of 1998 and a neo-noir film that had released in 1997, named not Iraq, but LA Confidential. It would provide the single largest cinematic inspiration for MGS2. Using it, Kojima comes up with a very rough sketch of the plot of the game. It goes something like this. It is 2006. 1 year after the Shadow Moses incident. Revolver Ocelot and the American president, secretly a third Big Boss clone known as Solidus, have spread Rex's test data MO disk around the globe for a hefty profit. Now it seems nuclear know-how has made it not only to the Big Five nuclear powers, but to even small-scale states like Iraq and North Korea. However, this is only a ruse. Left out of the data that's proliferated is the fact that Metal Gear Rex was never completed. Its power is purely theoretical, its proliferation purely an act of terrorism, to advance a secret plan known as the Arsenal Metal Gear Project, a concealed Metal Gear wearing the outward form of an aircraft carrier. But when this aircraft carrier gets hijacked by Liquid Snake and the revivified Sons of Big Boss, right in the middle of nuclear inspections over in Iraq and Iran, Solid Snake must defeat the terrorist and disarm the weapon before the incident triggers a Third World War. The game, Kojima envisions, will take place all within a single environment, just like MGS1, except this time, instead of an island, it will be an aircraft carrier. September 29th, Kojima workshops aspects of the premise with KCE Japan's military advisor. By this point, the aircraft carrier becomes an oil tanker. And when he realizes the scenario is too short, Kojima looks for inspiration not from a movie, but from a novel. It's called The New York Trilogy by Paul Auster. ''1998 is also the year, in the words of Wired magazine, the world woke up to Y2K. Every major news magazine gives Y2K prominent play and every major newspaper devoted space on its front page to the issue," end quote. Another phrase used to describe the supposedly impending doomsday is the Millennium Time Bomb.
Yes, midnight, December 31st, 1999, electronic clocks and millions of computers will roll over to the year 2000. Or will they? Most experts agree they will not. Computer systems essential to our way of life may simply shut down. The dire warnings in this emergency video are gleaned exclusively from secular experts in over 300 reports. The facts, no event in history has connected mankind to one common adversary until now. The millennial bug jeopardizes our way of life in ways never imagined. Thousands of programmers working round the clock may not fix this problem in time. Such potential mass confusion confirms end-time prophecy. The impending worldwide panic could signal the end of this age and Christ's glorious return. With only months before the moment arrives, you must have the information found in this shocking video by Dr. Jack and Rex Alabanapi. 2000 Time Bomb. To order, call toll-free 1-800-918-55.
The idea that the unification of the entire world onto a single system is now the very thing that threatens its own destruction must strike Kojima as comparable to the Tower of Babel. In Genesis Book 2, verses 1 through 9, the entire human race forms together using a single language and sets out to build a tower to reach heaven and take the place of God. To prevent them from doing so, God scatters them over the face of the earth and, quote, confused the language of the whole world, end quote, splitting human speech into its many different language groups. Paul Auster's first in the New York trilogy, City of Glass, concerns a father and son, both named Peter Stillman. Peter Sr. is a believer in the idea of a so-called prelapsarian, that is to say, an Edenic language, a pure tongue of God, where the words really are what they referred to. He comes to believe that the discovery of America opened the door to obtaining what had been lost in the fall out of heaven, so to speak. Given that the Babel story is believed to have taken place in modern-day Iraq, and given the real motivation for conflict in the Gulf may have involved preventing the so-called petrodollar from becoming the petro-euro, many connections can be drawn from the Tower of Babel to Y2K and to the seemingly imminent start of a second Gulf War. By putting all these things together, by October 6th, Kojima finalizes his planned direction for MGS2, which from here on out will also be known as the Hollywood game. October 25th through 29th, 1998. Now with its direction set, Kojima, first alone, then with key members of the dev team, hole up in Nasu, a small Japanese tourist town, to conduct a so-called game plan camp. The team begin by thinking not only about their rivals now, but what they'll likely be doing with the next generation of hardware. The Hollywood game concept derives from the realization that few game series feature sequels in the conventional sense. Most move from one standalone story or episode to the next. Yet conversely, they tend to do so only how a video game can, by linking titles through a shared or similar game system or world. KCE Japan resolved to use a hybrid fusion of the Hollywood and video game kinds of sequel, hence the phrase Hollywood game. But how to go about this, which involves enticing both series veterans and MGS2 entry rookies? While motion capture experiments get underway, to be teased in the expansion integral, the team ponder this new form of theoretical digital fusion. How do all three stories in the New York trilogy fit together? Theme and setting. MGS2, he decides, will be split into two pieces, one small, one big, unified not only by story elements, but more importantly, by theme and setting. Players who have beaten MGS1 can start off with the prologue, while Kojima plans for newcomers to be able to jump right into the main campaign. In this respect, MGS2 won't be only one game, but two. It won't be MGS2, but also three. Each one will feel tailor-made for each player base, and both will transpire in the same location. One on a moving object there, the other a stationary one. That location is decided on November 4th as the New York Harbor in Lower Manhattan. While working on the MGS radio drama series with KCE Japan's sound director Kazuki Muraoka, 5 days later, the two get to talking about MGS2 and sound. Without yet seeing the PS2 for a detailed study, they already know the console will feature DVD quality digital sound. The idea of making the true Hollywood game means, for both Kojima and Muraoka, true Hollywood sound. Who do they know from Hollywood with the right pedigree? Nobody. Dejectedly, or so the legend goes, the two directors decide to nurse their pains by catching a movie. Back during work on MGS1, the team had found inspiration by watching movies like Predator and The Rock. Maybe this one, too, will again give them some clue as to how to move forward. The movie is The Replacement Killers, a true 21st century globalization era action flick. Directed by a black American and led by a star of Hong Kong kung fu cinema, the film's soundtrack blows Kojima and Matsuhana away. Perfect fusion of Eastern instrumentation and Western synthesized digital sound. The score is strongly rhythmic and dramatic without being all that melodic. This, the pair realize, is exactly what MGS2 will need, given it will have to be scored in black box fashion, without being sure, in other words, of what action on screen is exactly occurring at any given time, or when it will need to change musically. The two directors decide to write the composer of the film a letter, and send it alongside a sort of mix CD compilation of the composer's work that they'd like him to build on for MGS2. That composer, who also worked, ironically, on The Rock with Hans Zimmer, is Harry Gregson-Williams.
The first thing I knew about it was that I had, through the mail, I received a CD of a lot of my pieces of music from a lot of Hollywood action films. The Rock, The Replacement Killers, Armageddon, Enemy of the State, and someone had put together a lot of music of mine and put it on one CD and sent it over to me and proposed that they would like their game to sound like and feel like a Hollywood action movie, and to do that they'd like a film composer to do the score for Metal Gear Solid 2. So flattery will get you everywhere, and as soon as I received that CD, I realized that I'd never done a video game before, why not do it? And they seem like very decent people, so that's how I came to be doing it.
November 12th, Kojima starts to conceptualize the development process for MGS2 along the lines of a computer network, by drafting a kind of proof of concept, a so-called grand game plan, and making it available digitally to the entire staff. Everyone will be on the same page via the power of electronic connectivity. He begins preparations for such a design document now. The same day, KCE Japan create a secure research lab at their offices in Yebisu Garden Palace Tower, which they name after the FOXP4 gene, which works as a transcriptional repressor that represses lung-specific expression. We might compare the way the PS2 functions to biologist Richard Dawkins' idea of the extended phenotype. Essentially, Dawkins thought the way biology up until then looked at how genes are expressed was like only focusing on, say, one component of a games console. In fact, Dawkins in his prime did not even see DNA as the end-all be-all means by which we pass on life, or evolve. One of the single most important nonfiction texts for all of MGS has to be Dawkins' classic, The Selfish Gene. Dawkins thought one thing in particular about human beings could not be readily or completely explained by genetics alone. That one thing is culture. There is a wider story there, one that, for Dawkins, goes back further and deeper than DNA, goes back to the underlying purpose of DNA and of culture alike, namely, the transmission and replication of information. Dawkins believed we humans had innovated or evolved the next method for replication in the form of what he famously called memes. It would be the subject of memes that MGS2 would center on, just as MGS1 had with genes. Clearly, Kojima and his writing team already had in mind Dawkins' memes and the language repression idea that we'll find eventually in MGS2's nanomachines, which render the hosts unable to speak the word patriots, repressing them and transcripting them, so to speak, as the phrase lalilulelo. This same repression of expression motif would heavily inform MGS2's marketing, which would lead many people to think that they'd be reprising their role for the entire game of Solid Snake. Even the opening pre-start menu trailer, so to speak, conveys these deceptions and lurking repressed truths. Directed by Kyle Cooper, who also worked on the iconic opening sequence for the movie Seven, we begin with hieroglyphics and Japanese calligraphy giving way to the Declaration of Independence, while Raiden, the secret new protagonist, shows his face only at the very last screen. That's right, with this they had found their second major name from Hollywood movie making. Seven, like City of Glass from the New York trilogy and LA Confidential, was also an investigation thriller. Initially, Kojima toyed with calling this game MGS3, using Roman numerals. Although he only mentions in the grand game plan one meaning behind this, that they symbolize the three tallest skyscrapers in Manhattan, there may be at least a few more meanings worth delineating here. In inorganic chemistry, Roman numerals express the number of electrons lost through oxidation. A mnemonic is a tool that helps you remember an idea or phrase as a kind of code or a cipher. And one such mnemonic in chemistry is oil rig. Oxidation is loss, reduction is gain. This relates to the principle that electrons carry a negative charge. Of course, it also could imply a gap in the record, so to speak, a repressed break in the sequence. As Kojima's grand game plan conveys, his goal was to transfer over most of the underlying elements from MGS1, with a loss or conversion of some of the characters' themes and motifs from the original, in order for the sequel to double as a standalone game to be enjoyed by newcomers and veterans alike. The function of calling it MGS3 effectively puts both veterans and newbies in the same confused boat. Scattered, in their confusion, much like the human race after the Tower of Babel. In the design document, Kojima observes that most games become a successful series by standalone sequels, as we've discussed. MGS2 was envisioned as a kind of fission, as a movie sequel and a game sequel. Another fission Kojima envisioned was between men and women players. MGS2 would feature more prominent women characters, not only in supporting but in main roles, to not only combine target demographics, but showcase how, in Kojima's own words, the 21st century, the third century of the American Empire, would be the age of women. In the preliminary draft of the grand game design document, Kojima writes that he envisions MGS2 as a series of spy versus spy and betrayals, a game iteration of LA Confidential, where not everything your eyes tell you is the truth. MGS2 will be a game where the player will come to question if what we call reality is even itself really the truth. A game laden with ironies aimed at the digital society and gaming culture. By this point, January 1999, the plot of the game has been fleshed out a lot more. Here's how Kojima outlines his ideas. Quote, Tanker Chapter, only available to players who have played MGS1. Having learned of the development of a prototype Metal Gear Interceptor, an amphibious Metal Gear, Snake, working for the anti-Metal Gear organization Philanthropy, infiltrates a large tanker traveling through New York Harbor. Supported over the codec by Otacon, HAL, Snake, Dave, discovers a new type of Metal Gear Ray, inside the ship. Also inside are several hundred US Marines, as well as the Commandant of the Marine Corps, hardly the sort of deployment supposedly there only to guard Ray. Avoiding the troops, he cannot use firearms, and knocking them out when necessary, Snake makes it to the Metal Gear. But then at that very moment, Ocelot and Gerlukovich suddenly appear, seizing the prototype. After taking control of it, Ocelot kills the Commandant, crushes Gerlukovich and his men, and fires a massive beam from its mouth, sinking the ship along with Snake. Ocelot then disappears into the depths of the ocean. Approximately 1 year after the sinking of the tanker off the coast of Manhattan, an oil fence has been laid around the New York Harbor area in order to contain the crude oil leaked from the tanker. After the accident, a massive offshore decontamination facility, Big Blue Apple, is constructed at the site of the spill. The American airstrikes on Iraq, in retaliation for the country's refusal to agree to weapons inspections, are scheduled to begin 2 days from now. It is on this day that the offshore decontamination facility is captured by members of Dead Cell, a Navy SEALs anti-terrorism training unit, after they occupied the plant under the guise of conducting a drill. They have also taken hostage the president as well as a VIP from an environmental group, both of whom were there inspecting the plant at the time. This is a critically important time for the president, with the deadline for confirming the airstrikes fast approaching. The terrorists, having planted C4 explosives around the plant, order the surrounding area cleared. Should the facility explode, it would turn the entire harbor into an inferno and render the city of New York uninhabitable for half a century. The last member of Foxhound, codenamed Raiden, a rookie, is ordered to infiltrate the plant. Although in actuality, Foxhound no longer exists. The original Metal Gear Solid had been set in Alaska as a subtle nod to the market undergirding American power, petroleum. The game was drawing parallels between oil and nuclear power as two complementary forms of harnessing energy in a literal sense. But with MGS2, the focus transitioned somewhat from so-called hard power to soft, how the US had maintained its global hegemony at the turn of the century via controlling information, not only in terms of fact versus fiction, but also in terms of norms. From the United Nations to the practices of environmentalism and philanthropy, MGS2 was a revolutionary portrayal of the concept of soft power in the games industry for the first time. MGS1 was to atom bombs what MGS2, as the perfect sequel, was to the second generation of nuclear weapons, the hydrogen bomb. In this respect, controlling the flow of information became a key concept. Some specifics about hydrogen bombs and their inner workings remain secret from the public even today. Yet, similar processes are necessary in nuclear fission-powered reactors. This brings up another key concept for MGS2, namely dual use, which roughly means technology and information that has simultaneous civilian and military applications. The plant chapter opens with information on the link between nuclear weapons and information technology, showing how both were in fact products of the post-war age. Hideo Kojima would later tell reporter Tim Rogers that his goal with MGS2 was to, quote, make a video game that told a story that could only be told in a video game, end quote. According to Rogers, Kojima's, quote, first and foremost goal was to, quote, use the medium which is inherently post-modern, end quote. In this respect, Kojima would take inspiration from a second literary work, Kangaroo Notebook by Kobo Abe, and like Paul Auster's The New York Trilogy, The Kangaroo Notebook is also a work of postmodern literature, where appearances and common sense constantly conflict with reality. By this point, a number of characters are sketched as concept art who won't make it into the final game, and many of their names are allusions to The New York Trilogy by Paul Auster. Perhaps one of many possible explanations behind the Roman numeral 3. There's Max, or Maxine Work, essentially a Western analog to replace Mei Ling. She would quote Shakespeare instead of Confucius, and she'd quote use tricks and traps with save data before getting revealed at the end as an AI construct. In City of Glass, an author named Daniel Quinn writes detective fiction from the perspective of a solid snake-like hero named Max Work. There's also Doc in MGS2's grand game plan from January of 1999. Doc is short for Dr. William Wilson. He was intended to serve as an analog to MGS1's Hal Emmerich as the brilliant technician behind this game's Metal Gear arsenal. He too is described as an AI construct. William Wilson was Daniel Quinn's pen name in City of Glass. Meanwhile, the Colonel was only to resemble Campbell from MGS1. His name was going to be Daniel Quinn. Also described in the design document are Chinaman, who will be fused together with an early idea to become the fully realized character named Vamp, and Old Boy, who will, years later, return to MGS properly as an aspect of the character Code Talker. Each of Auster's three stories in the New York trilogy are thematically interlinked to weave a sort of tapestry. In general, all three are about the maddening pursuit of capital T truth and how that Tower of Babel-like project inevitably gets drowned in a veritable sea of information. The more data there is for us to crunch and interpret, the harder it becomes to pin down context. This brings up another crucial related idea to MGS2, the so-called frame problem of artificial intelligence. But we'll get to that later. The name Sons of Liberty derives from a real group of terrorists from the Revolutionary era who destroyed British printing presses and persecuted citizens of the Crown in the name of freedom, patriotism, and equality. The 1990s were also a time of huge leaps and bounds for the subject of artificial intelligence. During Desert Storm in 1991, DARPA, who played a prominent role in the story of MGS1, put 3 decades worth of development into practice with a logistics AI program called the Dynamic Analysis and Replanning Tool, DART. DART made DARPA a huge profit by reportedly saving the US military millions of dollars by allowing for on-the-fly adaptation to changing conditions in a crisis environment. From this initial spark, a whole host of huge AI advancements quickly followed throughout the decade. In just 1993 alone, the MIT COG project started an audacious plan to build a humanoid robot by the year 1998. Meanwhile, Lotfi Zadeh at UC Berkeley wrote a landmark paper called Fuzzy Logic, Neural Networks, and Soft Computing. It represents one of the earliest explorations into the subject we know of today as machine learning. By 1998, Tiger Electronics unveiled the first AI-based domestic robot called Furby, and the so-called inventor of the World Wide Web, Sir Timothy John Berners-Lee, publishes a paper that will produce standards by which the entire internet will soon become data machine readable, paving the way for the algorithmically based search engines and data platforms like YouTube and Google, which, by the way, was incorporated in 1998, that we use today. This subject of AI would be at the heart of MGS2. In fact, the original name for the big shell, Big Blue Apple, may in fact be a reference to the IBM computer that was the first to defeat a human grandmaster at chess in 1997, Deep Blue. Moreover, this would extend from the story and themes down even to the way that MGS2 will be designed. By the time KCE Japan will commit to the idea of utilizing bespoke facial expressions, around the same year of 2000, Cynthia Breazel at MIT publishes a dissertation on sociable machines, which describes the theoretical basis for Kismet, a robot with a face that can register and express a mimicry, a meme of human emotions. But the concept of virtual reality will also come to the forefront for MGS2 as a metaphor for the so-called new world. The dynamically changing digital environment to be featured in the game allows situations with, quote, multiple condition forks that change what happens depending on the circumstance, end quote.
This is,
What?
Nothing. It's nothing. But this isn't a photo of Metal Gear anyway. Sorry, but you're gonna have to go back and shoot another set.
Visual design for Metal Gear Ray would draw inspiration from Ridley Scott's film Alien from the 70s. Initially, just to experiment with the PS2, the team builds a replica of the heliport from MGS1, as well as a PS2 version of Metal Gear Rex. One of the first environments completed by the team is of a room that looks remarkably similar to the visual style of Metal Gear Solid 1. This dingy, dirty aesthetic would be dropped for a much sleeker, smoother, more digital age style. Late November 1998, the team finally get their hands on a test kit PS2 graphics board, and they're amazed at what they find. The console's aforementioned EE unit is like a data and information superhighway. using 10 different floating point multiply accumulators, or FMAX, the EE can work with the console's graphics synthesizer to calculate vectors and draw 3D in real time incredibly quickly. Remember how we said that with dynamic multimedia digital devices, the instruction code is simpler and the amount and density of data much greater? Well, the EE is built to accommodate this. It machine gun fires commands into the GS by way of a third subcomponent, the GIF, or Graphics Interface Unit, which is inside the GS. Put somewhat reductively, the EE generates the orders, the GIF manages and sequences them, and the GS executes them, a real division of processing power across three branches. Put simply, the PS2 isn't just capable of pretty visuals via CGI, like a device in CAX, meaning computer-aided technologies, for example, using supercomputers to test without field testing next-gen nuclear weapons. The PS2 is capable of running wholesale physicalist simulations. It's the difference between, say, movie making on a set and virtual reality. KCE Japan resolved to use this next-gen technology to do more than what's predictable. Instead of making heavy use of CG-rendered graphics, as you might expect from a so-called Hollywood game, they'll focus on expanding MGS1 mechanically to enhance not its visuals, but its entire pseudo-world, its entire X-factor, being the tension of stealth. But how to accomplish this? Well, by advancing everything surrounding the visuals, from guard behavior to number of enemies to a naturalistic pseudo-environment. The plan quickly snowballs into one of making a total stealth action simulation and the ultimate pseudo-reality as the true Hollywood game. December 2nd, 1998. The core team make a presentation to Konami, petitioning the publisher for funding to conduct basic research into the PS2's system architecture. The very next day, KCE Japan begin to build the staff for MGS2. By the end, the number will balloon to over 80 different personnel. On December 10th, the team secure the continued expertise of Motosada Mori. His seminars on the fundamentals of special forces teamwork and counter-terrorist operations will prove deeply pivotal for Sons of Liberty. As KCE Japan were completing a growing number of projects from MGS audio dramas to further localization efforts for MGS1 to preliminary work on Zone of the Enders, the staff was given access to the grand game plan as it was being developed. On December 18, 1998, leaders of the upcoming project led a presentation within Konami's in-house dev school. It was here the medium poly Mei Ling character model that we would see in MGS Integral was revealed for the first time. January 13th. Experiments in a toon shading, not unlike 2002's Wind Waker, begin. This will soon be dropped, specifically on February 16th. But not before an attempt to bring Shinkawa's illustrations across in 3D in experiments that begin on January 25th. 3 days later, the game plan becomes accessible by the staff as HTML. It is now 12th of February, 1999. For the new protagonist, Raiden, the team decide on a kind of ossified, androgynous look. The mocap actor for Raiden will be told to move without gender, making it possible for a woman player to theoretically project herself into the role while playing. Here's how the dev team for MGS2 structured itself. At the top of the pyramid, so to speak, of course, is the director. Under him, the script unit, who designs maps and project details while making job orders to all the other sections. The script unit is also in charge of binding completed models, sounds, and programs with the in-house language, GCL, while making game adjustments. Under the script unit are the three different divisions, program, design, and sound. There's also an auxiliary unit tasked with developer support. Thanks to early research before development really commenced, the systems unit, a skeletal section that deals with 3D calculation, drawings, DVD access, script processing, and other processes, were able to make a maximum use of the PS2's power. The character unit, meanwhile, used medical references to study shoulder motions and muscles for facial expressions. Most motions by the motion department, meanwhile, were not from motion capture, but done from scratch. February 25th, Konami signed off on a higher budget estimate for the game's development. 2 days prior to the European debut of MGS1, KCE Japan and the rest of the world officially learn of the PS2's specs. March 15th, Kojima begins a series of lengthy talks with songwriter Rika Muranaka about what will become MGS2's iconic Hollywood Golden Era-style jazz big band finale, Can't Say Goodbye to Yesterday. The stage unit visit a Japanese container ship in Kobe to conduct photo research. But with both the Toon and the Shinkawa Touch art direction styles now rejected, the team have no idea what their game will wind up looking like. On April 2nd, they hold a meeting to evaluate MGS2's character direction. After a second discussion with Muranaka, on April 26th, 1999, Kojima sends her conceptual lyrics for the theme she'll transform into the finished project. With the beginning of summer, it's clear that the situation in the Middle East is heating up too hotly for KCE Japan to remain comfortable with the wider context that they've planned of an Iraqi or Iranian nuclear inspection. By May 13th, the team have begun a solution to the art direction question. The character models will themselves remain relatively low or medium poly. This will free up the remaining resources, which will go instead to things like facial expressions and much more significantly, environments. But before full-scale development begins in earnest, later this summer, Kojima and the team attend E3. While they're in Los Angeles, they visit Kyle Cooper and Gregson Williams in LA to touch base before flying for a momentous photo research shoot in Manhattan. It is here that they gain source reference material for a host of different objects in MGS2, taking pains to gain footage of the underside of the GW bridge to the NYPD's bomb disposal suit. Bombs, after all, from Bin Laden's to the Millennium Time Bomb are all the rage in 1998 and 99. Here's the footage the team shows Kyle Cooper to initiate his work on the MGS2 opening sequence. It's not much, but it seems designed just to give the Hollywood veteran a sense of what their game will look like. As they begin the hunt for a vocalist to perform Can't Say Goodbye to Yesterday, members of the team attend a lecture by Mori on SWAT and counter-terrorist tactics. These include team tactics, sniping, and most importantly of all, room clearing in hostage situations and teamwork. And before the unveiling of MGS1 Integral, the research unit take a visit to the Museum of Ships. It's here they photograph not only a deep-sea diver suit, but a replica of the Universe Ireland, a ship built by the Gulf Oil Corporation in 1968. At the time, it was the largest ship in the world, a veritable Titanic. Its activation marked the opening of an offshore oil terminal outside Ireland, which was memorialized by the Clancy Brothers' song, Bringin' Home the Oil. However, on the 24th of November 1978, this became the site of a major tanker explosion, which caused 2 weeks of toxic and flammable gas-borne pollution. This would be known as the Beetlejuice incident, and it would directly be alluded to by the cover story offered by the Patriots in MGS2. Kojima envisioned MGS2's design as an extension of the hardware's dynamics. Not only would MGS2 improve the visuals of its predecessor, much more of a priority would be using, quote, the machine's advanced capabilities to expand the game's mechanics. We will use the PlayStation 2's capabilities to strengthen Metal Gear as a game. Instead of building up the visuals, we will build up its world, end quote. MGS2 would not focus on graphical fidelity discreetly, but on the wider simulation dynamics. For example, light and shadows were now part of the stealth gameplay. Enemy AI became more context sensitive and unique. But many of the most important changes made revolutionary use of the entire 3D environment. The addition of first-person mode aim, for example, integrated high, middle, and low regions of the game world into a more pseudo-realistic continuum. Each user module program is written as a completed part, or actor, by the program unit, Kazunobu Urihara, and placed in-game by the script unit, led by Matsuhana and Fukushima, which will increase development efficiency compared to MGS1. But the same subcomponent-based efficiency can be observed in MGS2's memory map. Of the 32 megabytes of available access memory offered by the EE, 4 megabytes each is afforded to the program domain and digital memory access data work for image drawing. Another twin set of allocations, this time only 512 kilobytes apiece, is apportioned to miscellaneous data and streaming work. Streaming is how the original Metal Gear Solid handled comprehensive use of voice acting across such lengthy cinematic cutscenes. Utilizing the principle of real-time operation, streaming in MGS 1 and 2 embodies the distinction between dynamic and static multimedia devices and software, which we've discussed. The data from the CD or DVD is read and played in small amounts via repeated loops, which enables the large amount of multimedia data to be generated. In MGS 2, two simultaneous streams can be played independently, allowing the important feature of emergent enemy radio dispatches, as well as the cute Easter egg that lets you respond to codec calls either positively or negatively with the L or R button sets, respectively, inside the protagonist's thoughts. All the sound-related processing is handled by the I.O. processor, which generates data in response to the call and command of the EE. The remaining free space afforded by the EE's memory in MGS 2 is split, not unlike the tanker and plant chapters, between one small and one big allocation, while 7 megabytes go to permanent data, which includes, quote, data of things used in multiple stages, like player and weapon data, end quote. 15 megabytes go to the stage-specific work area. One example of something KCE Japan make from scratch is MGS2's bespoke image drawing system, which works collectively by having each individual program only necessary to review a given object's display position and vertex information. This not only stays true to the fundamentals underneath the image drawing system used by MGS1, it helps to increase overall performance. This same Spartan efficiency and use of dynamic collective processes, so characteristic of its age, would also inform how MGS2 uses its video, RAM, and texture cache, which will be utilized as temporary storage for, quote, post-effects, as well as to make efficient use of the limited VRAM, end quote. Textures, meanwhile, are made into transferable Lego block-esque data units, which will only be necessary to transfer relative to the given object image drawing at a given time. This means not all the models that you see on screen are drawn there simultaneously. Texture transferring occurs at a, quote, average of 2 to 3 megabytes per frame, end quote. Using this piecemeal method allows to read onto the memory a maximum of 10 megabytes of textures per stage. But during the development cycle for MGS1, the team had run into a lot of trouble at the end getting everything to fit. They even had to, according to the main programmer Kazunobu Uehara, research some compression algorithms to get everything into the PlayStation's memory. Most of the CPU management is used to handle the graphics with MGS1. Enemy AI only takes up about 1-2% of the CPU. End quote. Collision-related processes, meanwhile, roughly took up 2-3%. MGS2 is intended to be something of the opposite. A graphically low-intensity game with more resources going to calculations. June 28th, KCE Japan hold a technical meeting with Sony about the PS2. Sony doesn't like for programmers to access the hardware directly, providing, typically, software libraries at a higher level of the architecture to make development easier and more dev-friendly. Since MGS1, however, KCE Japan prefer to do things their own way, the hard way, even the wrong way, using only the lowest level libraries as close to the hardware itself as possible to build out from them their own software libraries themselves. They'll do this again in MGS2 by innovating a number of closed system tools like the aforementioned GCL language and CVS server. June 30th, work is finished on a Raiden model with new joints, allowing for more complex dynamics and motion in cutscenes and in gameplay. Here it is. See how when he breathes, different parts of his body move interdependently? Those are the joints. A major unexpected shift in MGS2's development comes on July 7th. It's the Japanese debut of the film called The Matrix. The film features many of the themes and ideas that Kojima has intended for MGS2's plant chapter. Fortunately, that's a while off from finalizing. On the 26th, the script mint for the tanker chapter is complete. 3 days later, the team tries another technical experiment, this time one on the feasibility of facial animations in real time. August 6th, it's the anniversary of the Hiroshima bomb. It's been 54 years to the day. Kojima and his writing staff begin to workshop the plot of the plant chapter for the very first time. August 20th to September 2nd, 1999. After a final talk, Muranaka finishes writing the end theme, and it gets recorded in the birthplace of both jazz and nuclear weapons, New York. The next day, the team reviews its work on MGS2. Thus far. 10 days after that, the PS2 is announced to the world on September 13th, 1999. On the 26th, the research unit visits the Atsugi Aviation Show, where they'll gain important source images courtesy of the JSDF for aerial vehicles not unlike the Sikorsky MH-60R Seahawk made by the same weapons developer behind the Cypher UAV. After another eval session and the stateside release of MGS VR missions, on the 14th of October, the team holds what the Document of MGS2 will later call their spiritual boost party. That same day, Kojima meets again with Gregson Williams to provide paragraphs of words which he'll use to create the score for Sons of Liberty in lieu of the traditional method, using film stills. He'll also be shown an early sort of teaser for the game. Even though this is pre-rendered, it shows where the game's progress is at this point of late 1999. Between the 19th and 25th of November, following a third evaluation of the project, the schedule is redrawn. For the rest of the year, throughout December and into January of 2000, the team will focus solely on a series of mocap sessions. These will make MGS2 more like a Hollywood game hybrid than arguably any game before. On February 12, 2000, a demo reel is assembled to show Konami. This happens on the 18th. The emphasis is on the new feature the team has implemented to streamline efficient use of polygons via level of detail relativity. It also shows off both the upcoming game's use of facial animations and breakable glass objects. And of course, the internal demo will reveal snippets from the ending theme, sung by professional jazz chanteuse Carla White. It's here also that we get a very first glimpse at Olga. In this demo, MGS2 at parts looks almost like a late PS1 era Resident Evil game. The large number of enemy soldiers during alerts that we see here will be lowered to make them individually more threatening, while the camera angles will become less flat. Throughout the development of the game in this period, as another nod to the New York trilogy, which featured a unifying motif of notebooks, the entire team has to keep notebooks where they are required to write at least one design idea per day. Every night, directors Matsuhana and Kojima read over them, and if they find an idea they like, after running the idea by the program unit to ensure it'll work, they put it in the game. One of these notebook ideas that saves MGS2 from looking too much like a last-gen camera-style game is the feature of being able to look around corners to see better. Another example, maybe as a nod to 1997's Batman and Robin, is the freeze coolant spray for disarming terrorist bombs. Throughout February of 2000, as motion capture sessions start to require hiring and auditioning actors, Mori signs off on the authenticity of the tanker chapter, which is officially completed in dialogue form as of February 23rd. It is now that voice actors can be recorded in earnest. After another photo shoot session at the Fukuoka port, there's another meeting with Gregson Williams over in LA on May 5th. This, like the first meeting, is done during a trip for E3, where, after a premiere event at Universal Studios, the legendary, game-changing trailer for Metal Gear Solid 2, Sons of Liberty, is unveiled to an unsuspecting public for the first time.
I stare at the stars and the sky up above.
It ensures the game's status as a console seller. On June 1st, the research team travels to a sewage treatment plant and the famous Rainbow Bridge in Tokyo of the All Nippon Airways Flight 61 incident. June 20th, a second game plan camp in Nasu. Things are gearing up now for the final phases. Kojima once again isolates himself to work on the scripting, meaning all the branching possible bits of text and dialogue throughout the game. There's a third mocap session on the 6th of July. The trailer for E3 is such a hit in Japan that for a short time it's made available as a DVD rental starting on July 10th. The following day, Sony conducts a PR event at the highly respected French Film Festival in Cannes. On the 30th, the research unit visit a JMSDF, as in Japanese Maritime Self-Defense Force, destroyer for further source material. These will show up in-game on board the Discovery tanker. This is followed on August 20th by a research visit to the Yokosuka U.S. Naval Base during the public open house. Now it is September 2000. After one last review of the script on the 20th, on the 21st, the tanker codex script is deemed officially complete. On the 25th of September, the team visits a nuclear fuel processing plant. According to Kojima, in an interview with IGN on December 12, 2000, this trip included wearing the, quote, big bulky radiation suits. We all got Geiger counters to wear around our necks. The younger staff didn't really want to go there, end quote. 3 days prior, another important benchmark for the game's development came in the form of yet another trailer, this time for TGS in Tokyo. Following a review of the tanker chapter on October 4th and 5th, there's one more research trip to another JMSDF event called the Fleet Review on the 27th. Once more, for a third time, Kojima confines himself to work on creating further scenarios for the game on November 6th. By the 12th, the first test disc of the plant chapter is ready to be debugged, and thanks to how the game is put together, this can be accomplished relatively quickly. November 19th, KCE Japan present to Konami an MGS2 trial edition. 3 days later, the master ROM for this demo is completed, and on the 26th, the plant chapter script is too. After co-writer Fukushima handles corrections and revisions, by December 20th, the tanker chapter gameplay portion is officially completed. But Kojima sequesters himself a fourth time for further scenario design on January 17th of 2001. After reading over and checking the scripting for errors on the 23rd, by the 24th, the first half of the plant chapter's drama script is finalized. February 6, 2001, Naked Raiden's model is produced. By the 28th, English voice actor auditions begin in Hollywood. With the March 21st release of Zone of the Enders, there's included a copy of the MGS2 demo. And this is how I played MGS as a kid, by the way, for the very first time. Between March 2nd to 5th, voice recording commences at the TAVAC Studio, or Toei Audiovisual Art Center, in Shinjuku, Tokyo. More script checking on March 6th gets followed by more voice recordings and the completion of the plant chapter drama's second half. There's a photo shoot for a brochure featured in the MGS2 premium package on September 8th, 2001. 3 days later, terror incidents in DC and Manhattan cause a number of last-minute changes to MGS2. These include scrapping aerial footage of Arsenal crashing into Manhattan and footage of the towers and any and all American flags, except for the Sons of Liberty flag. After Sony Computer Entertainment monitor the game for any further last-minute issues, the US version, Master ROM, is finalized on September 28, 2001, 1 week after the US declares war on a word. The team received final approval by Konami on October 19th, whereupon they celebrate, as we can see here. After 3 years, 8 months of development by a team of over 80 people, Metal Gear Solid 2 Sons of Liberty finally debuts on November 13th, 2001.